Nigerian Diaspora Conference kicks off in Abuja today, as some Nigerians in all parts of the world is expected to be in Abuja for the program. Some of them who spoke to Ben Television concerning the conference said the idea of bringing together Nigerians who live outside the country to contribute their quota in the development of Nigeria is a laudable one.
Well, I expect that we're going to have a different kind of diaspora. We've had numerous diaspora events in the past, but you always find that after the event, many of the decisions and resolutions are not implemented. So this time, we believe that given the new administration, given the people who are actually organizing this event within the PEMSEC office, that we're going to have a very successful event that will translate to development for Nigeria in concrete terms.
Looking at the overall content of it, I see it as an opportunity, number one, to network with my peers from around the globe and, of course, from Nigeria. Then, number two, I see it as a platform to facilitate the integration and collaborations that we are looking for as people, Nigerians from the diaspora, integrating ourselves into the economic development of Nigeria.
You're talking about men and women who have exceptional skills in areas of education, in health, in youth and sports, in ICTs, you know, power and all other key sectors that are strategic to the development of this country. You know, these people have proven themselves in the countries where they are currently residing. And these are Nigerians. So this is a good platform and opportunity to encourage them, to welcome them. This is where we need them. Nigeria needs this group of men and women in diaspora.
The federal government has said the program is expected to create the much-needed awareness on why it has become imperative for Nigerians living abroad to contribute to national development.
On that first day, four official areas will be discussed extensively, namely, one, the available support for return of nationals and pilot diaspora investment projects, returnee diasporans and diaspora investment projects. Two, we'll be looking at how the nation can leverage on diaspora community to sustain our technological development. Three, we'll be looking at how the nation can also mobilize the diaspora for investment and create jobs in Nigeria. And finally, the fourth one, discussion on how the key agencies of the Federal Ministry of Industry, Trade and Investment can support the targeted diaspora investment in Nigeria. For this purpose, the Corporate Affairs Nigeria Investment Promotion Commission, Nigeria Export Promotion Council, the Bank of Industry, the Industrial Training Fund, ITF, Small and Medium Enterprises Development Agency of Nigeria, SMEDEN, will all participate in the pre-conference roundtable.
President Muhammadu Buhari is expected to declare the conference open on Tuesday. The theme of 2015 National Diaspora Conference is Diaspora and Nigerian Change Agenda. From Abuja, LM Chukwuemeka reports.
A member of National Assembly representing Kaduna Central in the Nigerian Senate, Shehu Sani, has offered himself for the second time to be an interface between the government and member of Boko Haram. In an exclusive chat with Ben TV in Abuja, Senator Shehu Sani said he's willing to spearhead the negotiation with Boko Haram if the federal government is ready.
I have in the past initiated I was the first person to initiate a dialogue process with the group, and I don't think I will have problem reaching out to the group up to this very time here. But you don't, these are not normal human beings that you simply call and reach out to them. For me to be able to reach out to the insurgents, I need to have a waiver from the side of the government. Because right now we have a law that prohibits any form of contact, communication, or reach out to the insurgents.
Mind taking a risk?
Well, I have, even before I become a senator, I've been taking risk. So if we can, if one person can die so that millions of people can survive, I don't think there is any problem with that.
Sunning also explained that the activities of Boko Haram in the northeastern part of the country is a serious threat to Nigeria.
The insurgency going on in the northeast is a serious threat to our freedom, to our democracy, to our peace and to unity. Now, if we are fully set to protect our people, the next thing we should do is to now open another window of the possibility of a dialogue. To dialogue with an insurgent group, you need to understand that you first of all have to do it from the position of strength. And then secondly, you have to do it from the point that is credible, because there have been claims of negotiation and dialogue in the past.
It will be recalled that Sheu Sani was once spearheaded negotiation with Boko Haram during the administration of the former president, Goodluck Jonathan, but he backed out due to alleged insincerity of the then government. Muyiwa Bamdele reporting from Abuja.
Member representing Aniosha Oshimili Federal Constituency of Delta State in the House of Representatives, Honorable Joan Onyemechi Mrakpo, has said that contrary to insinuations that the People's Democratic Party, PDP, has gone into extinction as a result of the last presidential election in the country, that the party has actually gone back to the drawing board to re-strategize on how to bounce back better. Honorable Mrakpo, who was speaking to Ben Television in an exclusive interview in Abuja, said that the party did all it could and lost gallantly in the last election.
Nothing ever went wrong with PDP, and PDP never went on vacation, and PDP does not have any reason to go on vacation. We've been there for quite a while, and Nigerians decided to look out and try out President Muhammadu Buhari. And if you watch results, which I want to believe that Nigerians have not forgotten, you saw the margin, the difference, the margin in winning. That was, if you want to say PDP lost, yes, we did lose, but that was a very, very gallant one. It was, we had the spread all over the place. Nigerians voted. PDP had the spread. PDP had its voice registered everywhere, and PDP came second, a very close second. So I don't think anything ever happened to PDP. It's a contest between two people, between two persons, between two political parties. But I want to say here that it wasn't even about APC, it was about Muhammadu Buhari. Nigerians wanted Muhammadu Buhari. They didn't care if he came out from Flower Party, any name. They just wanted Muhammadu Buhari. So fine, he was a flag bearer of APC, so it became APC's victory. But the vote wasn't for APC, the vote was for Muhammadu Buhari.
Speaking on the recent outburst of the Edo State Governor, Adams Oshiomhole, against the former Finance Minister Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, and by implication the government of the People's Democratic Party, Honorable Mrakpo said, those are just political statements that should not be taken seriously by Nigerians.
I want to say clearly that as time unfolds, there are so many things that will be coming up for Nigerians to see. My impression about him when he was NLC president and what it is now is totally different. It's totally different. I believe then that Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala wasn't lying about the challenges she had with some governors, especially people like governor like that of Edo State, And when a comrade, I don't know if he's still a comrade, Oshomole was talking and he had so much to say about Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, I didn't have my doubts that he was connected to that refusal. I want to clearly say that I believe, and that was what happened, that the attack on Okonjo-Iweala was purely over the refusal to grant the Edo State governor that loan. When persons just suddenly come up on her, take a second look on why they are doing that, and with time, why they are doing that or they did that will begin to unfold.
She also used the medium to assure the people of her constituency that she will do everything possible to attract federal presence into the area. From Abuja, I am Festus Ejiroga Nefifen for Ben Television.
Hi, Mike.
Babe, it's been over
12 hours. Are you done thinking about it?
Is he yes, is he yes?
Convince me.
I know how much
confidence style means to you. Let me take you somewhere.
What's that?
A superior leading international hospitality chain in the heart of Africa.
And?
They offer very distinct services. Their meeting halls and all their hotels offer conference solutions that can help plan a perfect function for any occasion. They feature outdoor catering and provide services for any size event.
Keep going. You got me thinking now.
The beauty, the decor, and the views. It's the hotel experience you always dreamed of. They have up-to-date entertainment and a variety served at the fast food restaurant and snack bar. Oh, and don't even get me started on the garden bar or the nightclub. You would have everything you need within your reach without having to go out.
Wow. So what if I want to
cook? They got you, babe. The rooms are thoughtfully furnished with facilities that aid proper cooking, just like you would at home.
Where is this place?
Bennett Suites.
Wow.
So, will you marry me?
Yes. How can I refuse?
Bennett Suites, a colorful affair.
The leadership of Nigerian Senate have been asked to promote wider and richer discussion on legislative motions before passage. Senator Mustapha Buka, representing Daura Central District in the Senate, made the observation in an interview with Ben TV in Abuja. Senator Buka, while reviewing the activities of the Senate before it went on recess, said the Senate should do more on the national discourse.
Motions, most of the discussion, they center around motions that are brought to the chambers. The motions are good, but the deliberations and contributions, you know, are limited. You could see so many senators raising their hands, and yet their contribution is not acknowledged. Unless you are able to talk, you can't get your views through. So I think to me that is a flaw in the area. So when we look at the rules, I think there are 13 things the rules mention about that. So we need to implement some of the things that the rules have said. At the same time, we have to have a time within which, you know, we have to consider some of the rules and revise them as we apply them. I know the ethics committee that will look at some of these things, but I think we can do better.
Senator Mustapha Buka also called on the National Assembly to embark on legislative procedure that will create enabling environment for job creation in the country.
One of the first areas is issue of unemployment. So as we come to the Senate, we must look at areas and we must work in tandem with the executive to see that one of the issues of employment is a major issue on the manifesto of the APC. So we will see how can we create jobs for the country. This we are doing a lot of research. We are also waiting to see when the government is fully established, you know, what they will bring to table and what contribution we can make to create employment. Because there are so many avenues that we can do that. That's one. Number two, my area is in the Sahel region. And that means we have a challenge with adequate water supply or adequate availability of water.
Muyiwa Bamdele reporting.
at the race for Kogi State governorship election continue to gather momentum. All Progressive Congress has so far screened and cleared 28 aspirants. This aspirant will slug it out in the forthcoming governorship primary in Lokoja.
The 28 governorship aspirants of All Progressive Congress have signed a peace accord that will guide the conduct of each aspirant during and after the primary. The organizing secretary of All Progressive Congress, Osita Izunazo, underscored the importance of the peace accord for the governorship aspirant.
This undertaking is intended to put all our aspirants in check. A situation where we have 28 aspirants is a good omen for our party. The 28 of you have qualified. So what it means is that within this number that we are seeing here, the next governor of Kogi State is here with us. Yes.
The chairman of the APC Governorship Screening Committee for Kogi State, Boss Mustafa, said all the 28 aspirants are qualified for the forthcoming primary slated for 29th of August 2015.
The committee received from the National Secretariat a total of 28 files and nominations. In addition to the party constitution, the guidelines for the nomination of candidates for public office 2014. The committee, in discharging its responsibility, was guided by the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, 1999 as amended, the Electoral Act 2010 as amended, the APC Constitution 2014 as amended, the APC Guidelines for the Nomination of Candidates for Public Office 2014. A copy of the guideline would be attached or is already attached to our report.
Meanwhile, the committee has submitted a report to the National Secretariat.
In this envelope, sealed, are four copies of the report of the Kogi State Governorship Nomination Screening Committee. I hereby hand over this to you for onward transmission to the National Chairman. Also in this envelope are the scorecards of each of the aspirants, the scores that were recorded during the processes of the interrogation by each member of the committee under the signature and the names of the members. This is for the purposes of authenticating the validity and the content of the report.
Cross-section of the governorship aspirants who spoke with Ben TV expressed their readiness for the primary.
More than prepared.
28 of you, sir.
The fittest. I'm very, very prepared. And I've gone to the grassroots. I've gone to the corner schooling of this state. I've seen the suffering of the people. I've addressed them. I've seen their problems. I've proffered solutions to them. And today in Kogi State, everybody is saying the governor we need is Dr. Yakin Abdullahi Habib.
Having contested the election for two terms into the Senate, I'm very familiar with the environment and I'm very much prepared for this race.
The delegates of nowadays are wiser than many people think. The delegates know what they are looking for. And having gone around the states, I am happy to know that the delegates are ready for us.
I know how to go about it, and I'm going to win. I'm prepared, very prepared.
That accord is very necessary, and I believe, starting from myself, who will abide by the provisions of the accord, I believe that all other members or all other co-aspirants will equally abide by that accord.
A member of the screening committee, Tina Adikwe, said the screening exercise was in line with the best practices.
I will like to describe the exercise as being free and fair. We suffered day and night. We were given a mandate of 7 days, but we tidied all this up under 4 days. We did a marvelous job. no taking of bribe. It was so transparent. Even as we interview some aspirants, they want to appreciate us. Our chairman will say, no, when you become a governor, you will see us there. You can give us whatever you want to give us. But for now, we are here to screen.
28 of them screened and cleared to contest the primary. Did not have to go and mobilize the party delegate ahead of the primary, but only one of them will be elected to carry the flag of the party in Kogi State governorship election. From APC National Secretariat, Abuja, Muyiwa Bamdele reporting.